I'm not sure when I joined, but I had odd experiences of linguistics even as a child. My dad was a philologist in the days when that meant literature and linguistics together. He had been in Prague as a young man and known all the Prague school people, was a friend of Jakobson's. Uh-huh. Had, when he came back to Finland, something around 34, written a paper on historical phonology, where he interpreted umlaut in the way that we now associate with Twadel much several years later, and it's a much better article. Uh-huh. And unfortunately, the Finnish linguistic establishment was extremely conservative, and they grudgingly allowed him to publish a short version of it and told him never to touch that subject again. So that was always kind of a painful memory for him. He used to talk about phonology, but he never got back to it. And then...
do you have a copy of his?
I have the paper, yes, I have the paper. It's in Finnish, unfortunately, but... I think it deserves to be translated.
We're all linguists.
It should. That's a Jakobson story. So, in 52, Sibiok invited my dad to give lectures on Slavic at the Linguistic Institute in Indiana. My mom and I went along, and that was very exciting for me. There were two things. There was a great deal of fancy machinery that had become available, sort of World War II stuff with tape recorders and visible speech sonograms. And people like Fred Householder and Zhao Yen Ren were playing with it, and they let me play with it too. So I remember doing palindromes into the Finnish palindromes, playing them backwards. They came out just right, except with a weird intonation. Yeah. But the most fascinating thing was that Carl Vogelin had organized field work for three of his students on Algonquian languages. There was Byron Bender, who's working with Tom Many Guns on Blackfoot, and Denny Salzman was working on Arapaho, and Dorothy, who I think is, I didn't know her last name then, but it's Dorothea Kashubi, I think, is working on Shawnee. And I, of course, had never seen a real Indian. And you can imagine, for a boy of 11,
yeah,
coming from Europe, what that meant. And I just loved hanging around with them. And they let me join in. I even took notes on, you know, I still have some yellow pads with Blackfoot. And Tom was a fantastic man. He had grown up in a monolingual environment with his grandparents, and his English was noticeably accent, so that he had been a movie star. I don't know, he had at least been in a movie with Shirley Temple in the 30s, so he had all sorts of stories. I thought that was really a great experience. I remember being bored by lectures, however, on theoretical linguistics. Jelmslev was particularly boring. But there was a great deal of excitement. You know, we think of structuralism as being somehow rather inert period, but there was a lot of ferment then. So, for example, psycholinguistics, I think, got started that summer with a conference that Sibiok organized, a lot of interesting people were there, Osgood and so forth.
Who are some of the other ones?
I think James Jenkins came.
Yeah. Right.
And I didn't really go into it, but it's something that is cited a lot. And there's linguistics and anthropology, and all the phonetics work was starting up. And so it wasn't as dull a period as it's made out to be in our in our history.
Did you get to know Fred Hasselhoff at all? I mean, it's kind of silly question since you were 11 years old. But he was a colleague of mine, and you mentioned.
A little bit, yeah. But not as closely as some of the others. I was very fond of Byron, Dandrin, and Dorothy.
How many languages could you speak then? I mean, it was in English. You spoke Finnish, obviously.
I grew up with three, Finnish, Swedish, and German, which was my home language. I had Swedish relatives, and Finnish was everywhere in school and on the street. Mm-hmm. And I learned English a little bit before coming, using a little book, English Through Pictures, which had these stick figures. I think the first page had a stick figure going like this and saying, I. And from there it went on. Uh-huh. And that gave me a leg up. But kids pick up languages very fast at that age.
So then what? Then you went back to Finland?
No, I went to England. So my father taught for 3 years in Birmingham. And that was great for me because I went to a really wonderful school which had classics as a prominent subject. And actually had a good tradition in classics, people like Tolkien and Enoch Powell, before he went into politics, was a very good classicist. And actually, one of my classmates, Michael Silk, is now professor of classics in London. So that was a wonderful school. And then I went back to Finland.
So, and now you have also Latin and Greek under your belt.
Well, school, a little bit of what you learn in school.
Yeah.
And then I did 3 more years of high school in Finland, and then I did a stint in the Finnish army, and I was trained as an interrogator of prisoners, which is a skill that transfers to dealing with students in some cases.
Morris was, we learned yesterday too, he was living in New York and he got drafted and then he was sent to Europe to interrogate people. I think he said he didn't, my impression was that he didn't get to interrogate very many people because the army had gone so fast into Germany that they were left behind and then finally shipped back, but he was going to be an interrogator too.
My father was one in the war as well. And then after that, I was a year in Alabama College on a fellowship. And I did a little bit of study in Helsinki University.
Were you studying linguistics?
There wasn't any linguistics really, but it was philology, let's say, reading Old English and Middle English, that kind of stuff. And then I went to Minnesota for a year and did some real linguistics there in an organized fashion with Cecil Wood, who did a very interesting Gothic course. And an anthropological linguist, Spencer, and Swanson, a classicist. So, and Jenkins was there as a psycholinguist. I got interested in that. Mm-hmm.
So what year is that now? Late.
That was 61.
61. And how did you hear about MIT?
Well, I wrote to Jakobson, and he said, well, there's two possibilities. You could go to Harvard, and you could go to MIT, but I don't recommend Harvard. And he was right. I'm very grateful to him.
Yeah.
So it's thanks to him that I was in that first batch of people.
So he was at Harvard?
He was in both places.
He was at
But he used to say he saved his best stuff for MIT.
Was Joshua Watmo the head of the department at Harvard at that point?
He was still there. He had been in charge of organizing the 9th Congress of Linguistics, which I was able to participate in, but he had somehow screwed it up and had been booted off the organizing committee, and the result was that Maurice Hallett took charge, and among his other accomplishments was to put Noam as a plenary speaker. So it was Noam and then four European luminaries, Kurilovich, Benveniste, I think maybe Glintz, and I forget who, and Kurilovich tried to criticize Chomsky, and Benveniste tried to criticize Chomsky. Chomsky very elegantly disposed of all of them.
And a lot of others too. I was I was amazed. It was I knew nothing, but I knew these were names like Hockett and he just sort of went down the list. Yeah. And I remember there was a long line of about 20 people making comments afterwards, and he seemed to know everything. Yeah. And just wasted.
It was extraordinary, yes.
Yeah. So you were at MIT at that point?
I had just come, yes. That was in 62, I think. And so I had been at the Linguistic Institute in Seattle. I had a choice after Minnesota of either teaching Pashto for the summer or going to the Linguistic Institute. And I'm not joking, it's for real. They used to have a system where the languages were taught in a team, so it was a native speaker and the linguist, and the linguist didn't have to know the language. It was just supposed to be a couple of steps ahead of the class. I don't know how it worked, but I'm glad I went to the Institute because I made a lot of good friends there.
Who did you take classes with and study with and learn from at the Seattle?
Well, it was Austerlitz, who taught the course in typology. And it was a lot of fun. It was Ferguson, who lectured, I think, in contrastive analysis. And maybe the most interesting was Bernard Bloch, who was still trying to work out Bloomfield's postulates and fix them so that they would actually work. Mm-hmm. And every class would come with a revised version, and people would challenge him and say, this doesn't work, and he would respond and come back and fix it. And this went on for the whole summer. And among other things, we learned that the glottal stop is phonemic in English. And when somebody in the class objected that that can't be right, it's not contrasting, he said, well, live and learn.
So was there a large group of people taking that project seriously?
Well, the class was very big and engaged. I don't think anybody was following up that work themselves, but it was kind of interesting to see.
Yeah. So that was 62?
That was summer of 62, yeah.
And then you came to MIT in that fall? Who was in your class there?
Oh, there was Sandy Shane.
Yuki
Kuroda, Samir Kumar Ghosh, who dropped out quickly when I was roomed with him in the first year. Brandy Qualls, I guess.
Peter Rosenbaum.
Rosenbaum, right. Yeah. Uh-huh. It's about six or seven people.
No, Barbara was the still the only woman student, right?
I think for a long time she was the only woman. She was in the previous class.
Right.
The first one, 61.
Right.
And then for several years there were no women as far as I know.
So who was on the faculty then when you came?
Well, Norman Morris and Hugh Matthews.
Yeah.
And Ed Klima.
Was Postal there?
Postal, I think, came maybe the year after or something. I don't think he was there the first year.
Was Jay Kaiser?
Jay Kaiser was around.
But he wasn't on the faculty, yeah.
Yeah. So Hugh Matthews had taught some very interesting things. It was a class in Suwon, and then there was a class, I'm a bit mystified, but he would take trees and rotate them 90 degrees or something. Some very fancy mathematical linguistics of inverted trees.
Yeah, that's right. He was a mathematical. I don't know. There wasn't any. Well, I was going to say there was no computer linguistics yet, but Vic Ingvie's project was already running, right?
And there was machine translation going on.
Yeah.
I don't know if at MIT, but that was running in the late 50s.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Vic was doing that at MIT in the 50s, and then he brought that back to Chicago. I don't know when, mm-hmm. but it would have been probably the early 60s.
I know he was still there when I arrived in January 64, and I think he was in that suite of offices, 20D102, where I think that was all... No, because Hugh Matthews's office was the glass enclosed office with a door, which must have been Vic's office when he was there. So I guess I came not to MIT, but I came to Hugh Matthews had come down to Penn, where he had gone for a PhD, and he gave a course once a week on comparative proto-soup.
Mm-hmm.
So I then reapplied to MIT, and they let me come in January of 64. But the summer of 63, there was a summer at MITRE, which is out in Bedford, and there were a bunch of MIT students. Bruce was there, Bruce Fraser, and Tom Bever, and Peter Rosenbaum, and Mike Geis, Arnold Zwicky, right? So, and I'm pretty sure, I know I met George Lakoff that summer, and I think, so in the summer of 63, I'm pretty sure Vic was there too, and then he must have left and gone to Chicago about that time, yeah.
He funded a bunch of people who were doing linguistics, among mm-hmm. them Jim McCauley, mm-hmm. and also Keith Percival.
Yeah, I remember.
They all came out of his project.
Yeah. I think of Keith as a historian of linguistics.
Well, he did some syntax and regular linguistics. He wrote a grammar of Toba Bata, which is still cited.
You know, when I saw you in December, you mentioned, we were just walking in the hall, that Ray Solomonoff had been around. And I always wanted to get back to you and ask you.
I wanted to ask you about him.
Okay.
Because, I read so much about him now recently in connection with Kolmogorov, Simplicity, and so forth, that he apparently was one of the people who thought of this idea.
Right.
And what interested me is that he says somewhere that he was inspired by Chomsky's ideas on linguistics.
Absolutely was. He was looking for a notation. He had the basic idea. He was looking for a notation. And when he heard Chomsky's, the paper Chomsky gave in 56, he realized Chomsky had it. So nobody before Chomsky had thought of a way to take syntactic structure and turn it into symbols that could that would be concatenated. It was this idea of an algebra as a concatenation of symbols. And people had phrase structure, people like Hockett. I mean, as Paul Postel points out over and over, a range of people had the concept of phrase structure. But nobody had an algebraic version of it. And that's what Chomsky provided. And when Solonov saw that, he was like, yeah, that's exactly what I need. Because he needed to compute the complexity of a grammar. And for that, he needed symbols. And it wasn't until Chomsky that was there. So
I got interested in this because of eponymy. So the principle there is that you choose the shortest complete description of the data in a regimented language, which is built on Sanskrit, but it's not random, but it's organized in a particular way according to certain conventions. So the analysis is just strictly guided by that, and usually it gets you the exact right results. Yeah. That is, it's very difficult to improve on Panini's analysis within that framework. Of course, you can import ideas that aren't there, but I've tried numerous times, or thought numerous times, that I could see a better way of doing it. Why didn't Panini do that? I'm always wrong. So. That's a fantastic thing, because out of that came so many great ideas, yeah. Like theta roles or rule ordering, or features.
Yeah. But linguists in the 19th century, like Whitney, just would not listen to the linguists who found inspiration in Panini. He said, well, Sanskrit is great, but those linguists, they didn't know what linguistics was.
Well, they tried to discredit Panini on empirical grounds, and they said that many of the examples that he cites or uses or derives can't be attested in the data.
Yeah.
But, of course, he was a native speaker, and there is a lot in the language that doesn't happen to have been written down. Yeah. Hmm. And people have found since that time that most of the things that Whitney objected to are actually either attested or very likely to have been there on historical grounds. So it's just a mistaken criticism, but it lives on. I mean, there are people who still are influenced by this skepticism that comes from those days. Mm.
So, so you were a student then for 3 years, essentially. You did your dissertation in
yes.
3 years.
Yeah. Well, that was possible in those days because there wasn't that much known, or at least we thought there wasn't that much known.
Yeah. So how did you... I remember your thesis was about analogy, and it seemed... there was a lot of what seemed to be the hot stuff going on among the students, and was much more generative grammar and so on. An analogy seemed like something out of a previous century, or seemed like a long way away from the sort of nuts and bolts stuff that was going on about cyclical phonology and kinds of trees and even generative capacity and all that kind of stuff. So I just wondered, how was it that that you arrived at doing that for a thesis?
Well, I just thought there was a natural connection. It's just a projection problem on the historical level. It's exactly the same problem that we have when we theorize about how a child learns a language. There are some givens, some biases, some data, and you project to a language from that. Well, that's exactly the mechanism that drives language change, because some of the wrong projections that a learner makes are going to become part of the language eventually. If enough learners make the same wrong projection, it becomes part of the language.
Am I right? Was it the first time that there was any historical linguistics in generative grammar?
No, actually, Morris had written an article, maybe 62, on sound change, where he argued that it was the addition of rules.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. I see. Okay.
And I think he had a more interesting point that sometimes you could add rules not to the end, but some in between. And because of ordering, you could get interesting results that were not so obvious.
Hmm. Ordering of phonological rules must have been a huge topic of conversation at that point. I think when I came to MIT in 72, it was still a really big deal. That's what, writing the rule was easy. It was relating it to other rules.
Yeah, that was another thing that my thesis was about, that some orders were more natural than others. So what I called feeding order and bleeding order, and that in fact there were changes that one could modulus reordering into these favored orders. Mm-hmm. And that kind of died out for a while, but it came back with optimality theory, because feeding and bleeding orders are the only ones that you can get with constraints. The other guys that are more complex, according to what I proposed before, are actually kind of intractable in OT, and you have to have special devices for dealing with them, such as sympathy or prec constraints, and they're all kind of hokey. So it's a live issue again. But I have straddle OT now for dealing with that. So what I think is the case is that when you get kind of the unnatural orders, it's because you have a later stratum masking the results of an earlier stratum.
Yeah.
And you actually don't have ordering. So you can have your cake and eat it.
We're in 1965, but maybe we just sort of move forward, and lexical phonology is something I'd love to talk about.
I wanted to say, since you mentioned Hugh Matthews, that I worked for him one summer. It was not 65, but I think it was 64, with Red Thundercloud, who was a Catawba Indian who Hugh had found somewhere, the last speaker of his language. And I spent a good part of that summer just working with him. Often Hugh wasn't able to make it. And that was another very romantic experience.
The last speaker.
The last speaker. And again, I was still very excited about, you know, this.
You know, I was just thinking about generative grammar being applied to other languages, and I think the first at MIT was Hugh doing Hidatsa syntax. I think that was at least the first one I knew anything about. And in fact, there was Manfred Birwisch writing doing a grammar of German, because I think Bob Lees visited him and his group of people in East Berlin and got him sort of rolling, and then there was one of his publications, which was, I think, this the structure of the German verb or something like that, and then. Well, there was phonologies, you know, Morris was always working on uh, I remember, I don't know if you would like to read into the record, a story I learned from you, which was Morris gave this course on the history of Russian accentuation, and Leitner was in the course, and a whole lot of luminaries from Harvard, and do you remember what you told about it?
Why don't you tell it?
You told me that it was how you lost your fear of MIT, because I was always terrified, first of all, because you know you're probably going to crash into a Nobel laureate when you're walking down one of the long corridors, and so, and then I came, and having been rejected for my first application, then I came, and I was let in, I was only allowed to be a special student and take one course, Morris's course, which I did, I think, quite poorly in. So my fear was trying to throw in buzzwords at plausible places. I remember derived constituent structure. I knew that was important. I had no idea what it was, and I was trying, you know, weave it into conversation. So, but anyway, you told me how you had lost your fear, and it was in this class on the history of Russian accentuation, and you said Morris would always say, okay, we'll start out and say, the first rule for Russian accentuation is the following, quiet in the classroom, and the second rule was this, and then somebody, Horace Lunt, would say, well, in Polish, that's not quite right. But by the third rule, more sort of trouble. And the whole time, Leitner was getting more and more vociferous. And the class ended in confusion. And the next week, Morris said, forget everything we said last week. Here's the correct set of rules. Here's rule one. Again, the process, identical week after week. But finally, Leitner getting more and more incensed. And finally, at one time, in the midst of this dispute, Leitner said, ah, Hallie, you're full of shit. And Morris looked at Ted and probably put the chalk in his mouth as he was thinking. He said, and the next rule.
But I think Hallie and Chomsky encouraged that kind of attitude themselves by really being very clear that they were making it up and expected it to be wrong. They themselves would always go back, and next week it would be a better version. And that was my first experience with Chomsky's class. I think the fall of 62 I came, he was doing the noun phrase, you know, the determiners and predeterminers, and, you know, three of all the many people.
And the ring of truth, and when it's only, I remember, I've seen, I think that there's a whole lot of real actual stuff, which I think has just vanished. It was a sort of a handout. I don't think it was ever, some of it was published in one of the Texas talks, but I remember somebody gave me the handout and had a lot of...
I mostly remember enormous phrase structure rules written on the board and being erased. Replaced with new ones, and this went on week after week, and I decided I would never become a syntactician. But it was like that, and in fact, Noam was very unhappy if he didn't get argued with, and he wanted to provoke and wanted people to take issue with him. That was when he got interested. He did not want people to believe him.
Yeah, and he also, I don't remember if there were actual papers that Chomsky wrote with any student, or there might have been, do you think there was one which Morris wrote? But I certainly had the feeling that it was sort of, if there was a membrane between the faculty members and the students, it was sort of permeable, and students and somebody in the faculty would work together, you know, and I thought that was incredibly wonderful, you know. I remember, I think probably where such papers would have surfaced would have been in the QPR, which came out four times a year, the research laboratory. I remember Bever and Langendone had a thing about the rules of Proto-Indo-European and the EO Aplaut going back and forth each.
Well, it's true that there was a lot of back and forth, and there was no sharp stratification. It's very much of a communal venture. And also, there were a lot of people from outside the department who were around. So yeah. It was a very rich environment. People came, visited, yeah. Interesting people who were attracted by Chomsky mainly, and who came for a year or whatever.
Who do you remember?
Well, it was 1 year. Searle was here. It was a very noticeable presence in Chomsky's lectures. Mm-hmm. There was the second year I was here. There was a whole bunch of, maybe the third. There was a bunch of Japanese people. They were all trying to work out wa and ga, and Chomsky was sitting in on that. Nothing ever came out of it because people didn't understand the basic syntax of Japanese. So what always happens is people go for the most interesting or exotic phenomenon, but they can't solve it because they don't understand the more basic ones. So there was talking of working on other languages, Japanese very early. And, mm-hmm. By the way, Postol was working on Mohawk.
Well, that's right, Postol had done Mohawk. Yeah, so, you're right. So it was him. Yeah.
Very early, there was a lot of stuff. And then another person who I learned a lot from was Kurilovich, who was here for 2 years lecturing on Indo-European. And lots mm-hmm. of people came. And he presented 1 year, it was basically what became his book, Inflectional Categories on Indo-European.
Did he talk about the syllable? That was something that wasn't part of MIT phonology, generative phonology, until
the mid-70s. He just assumed the syllable.
Yeah.
And I think it wasn't in some pattern of English for formal reasons, because they didn't know how to construct it in the vocabulary that they had, with features and so on.
Both Ali and Chomsky were very dismissive of it. I remember Ali more than once saying, oh, the syllable, it's just, this is how you talk, that's all there is to it. And I remember a story of Dan Kahn, who wrote his dissertation on it, and he had regular meetings with Chomsky, and he was in the same office that I was as a grad student. One day he had an appointment with Chomsky, and he just had the argument down cold. There was no way to get out of his argument for the syllable. And he came back from his meeting with Chomsky, and he was crestfallen, or worse.
Yeah.
And
so he
said,
had gotten out.
What happened? And did Chomsky not accept your argument? Did he find a hole? And Dan said, no, he couldn't find a hole, but he said that, well, if that's true, phonology isn't interesting.
The syllable came out of its limbo a bit earlier. I think it was 66, but before Kahn came here. And it was C.J. Bailey, another one of those interesting visitors, who did a whole lot of English phonology about southern dialects and how their syllabification differs. It was all extremely interesting. And at that point, also Milner, the He was here. And the syllable was talked about a lot, and Milner became very excited. He said, this is just what they need for the theory of French verse. So it was there, at least semi-officially, even before Some Pattern of English was published. But Kahn made it official in his thesis. So that was one of my earlier students, still around, still working.
And David Stamp, I remember he was a visitor my first
year. Yes, he was. That must have been 67.
72, 73.
Oh, 70, much later than that. Yeah. Well, yeah, by then it was just completely accepted by everybody. I think by that time Chomsky wasn't doing phonology anymore.
No, he wasn't. And the story about him would have been in 75. So, lexical phonology.
Well, it just seemed a natural development of phonology along the lines that people were doing in syntax, right? So there was Emmons and the idea of two kinds of transformations, and the analogy seemed very straightforward, and it solved a lot of problems, and also gave me a basis for historical linguistics. That was good, and actually, a number of people had similar ideas. So David Pozetsky wrote a paper about Russian, which had essentially the same idea.
It always seemed to me that the idea of the rules of the lexical phonology, as opposed to the post-lexical phonology, and this notion of structure preservation fit in very neatly with the Harris-Hockett view of morphophonology, that there's a deep analogy between the lexical phonology on the one hand and their morphophonemics, and the post-lexical phonology and their phonemics, the rule of alphabet. Did that feel like a natural connection to you? Or?
I hadn't thought of it that way. I don't know exactly whether that's right. I thought that it had something to do with contrast. And that was not the point of lexical phonology. That is, you didn't segregate processes on the basis of whether they led to contrast or not, the way the structuralists did. In fact, I think the really important divisions between rules have to do with things like locality and the domains, and not with whether they lead to contrast or not.
So, there is no way of recapturing the notion of contrast, of the basically distinctions which speakers can hear as opposed to those they can't hear?
Well, you can recapture it. It turns out to be a very complicated notion for several reasons. One is near contrasts. So there are many documented cases of people or communities producing phonemes ways that are systematically distinct, but they can't hear the difference. Even in their own speech, when it's played back to them, they can't hear the distinction. So that kind of undermines the whole notion of contrast, right?
And the other, it is also true, the other thing, where they swear there's a difference, and it's not there acoustically, at least with anything can be measured. So you're saying maybe it's a good notion to get rid of.
Well, it's a much more complicated notion and not much good as a foundation for all of phonology.
Yeah. So this is over my head because I don't know how optimality theory works, but I know it was it came along later. And how did how did you hear about it and get interested in it, and were you opposed to it at the beginning, or was it in fact did it seem to conflict with lexical phonology, or how?
I guess I heard about it first some talks by Prince and McCarthy, must have been 91 or 92, and I thought it was great because we had always had constraints, at least I had always had constraints, but I had constraints and rules, like most people and like a lot of people still have. And it was always very difficult to choreograph them because the constraints could either block the rules or they could repair violations that the rules created, and sometimes you had to distinguish between two kinds of constraints, the ones that block, the ones that repair. And it was a mess, and it actually was intractable when you really pursued it, and that was shown by, for example, Carol Paradis and various people who had tried to develop explicit constraint and repair models. It works so informally, but if you really try to work it out, it's just a disaster. So what was great about OT is that you got rid of the rules, and you could do it all with constraints and ranking of viable constraints. So that was wonderful. Then the downside was that there was a lot of things you couldn't do. I mentioned already that you can't do opaque rule ordering, or you can't do the effect of what would have been opaque rule ordering in the ordered rule theory. That's where straddle OT came in, because that provides you a way out. It still keeps the essential architecture of OT, but just adds cascades of OT phonologies corresponding to the word, the phrase, maybe also the stem, and that gives you not just opacity, but also gives you a nice way of dealing with cyclicity, which is the second problem that arises if you get rid of rules. Right? So the idea that big words contain the effects that are there in the small words or stems from which they're derived. You know, you've written about these things when you did phonology.
Yeah.
When you remember teaching phonology?
I do, yeah. Because Morris and Noam were sick of sound patterns. They had been working on it for 12 years. It was finally finished. So they said, okay, somebody else has to teach it. And I thought, well, I would do it with you, and that since I had written a paper on German strong verbs, I thought, well, I'll do the segmental phonology, and you'll do the sort of stress stuff, which I didn't know anything about. And then it turned out that I found an extra case. I found words which they hadn't noticed in sound pattern, words which nouns which had a lax final vowel but was stressed, like Quebec and Tibet and stuff like that.
Case F,
that's right, yeah. And it turns out when you find case F, then everything sort of gets... it sort of gets simpler. But then there's many... one of the sort of, I might say, almost political reasons for sound pattern was, which they just mentioned in the beginning, is that they suggest submitting, I think George Bernard Shaw had a prize of $100,000 for anyone who could develop a better orthography of English. And so what they said is, we're going to submit regular orthography and say that it's perfect, and that stress is completely predictable. But of course, It's only predictable if you are allowed to make the underlying representations secretly code where the stress is going to show up. So, yes, I remember doing that.
Yeah. That was, I think, even before the book had appeared.
I think so too. Yeah, I think we had chapters that we could look at
and
proofs and stuff.
There was a certain amount of annoyance that the book hadn't appeared yet and we were already trashing it.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
Did it have any impact on people at the time? The article by Fred Householder in 65 in Journal of Linguistics. In retrospect, I've heard people cite that as a strong critique of generative phonology. And Fred didn't think it was intended in that way, and I just wondered in 65, was anybody aware of it?
Yeah, I think we read it and talked about it, but it wasn't really taken all that seriously at the time. Some critiques were. So, for example, I remember an article by Gilbert Harman on phrase structure grammar.
Yeah.
And that was, that caused major alarm. There was a meeting of the department and we all read it and talked about it. It was like, you know, we're under threat.
Yeah.
But Householder's article was not received in that way. I mean, we read it and I think the thing about Harman's article that it had a serious formal basis, and that was not the case for Householder's article.
Right. Yeah. And Harman had been working for a bit Ingvi. That work that he did was specifically in Ingvi's land. He did it.
Yeah.
Ingvi was not a co-author, but sort of close to it.
Yeah. And so anything that was had the Ingvi taint had to be really, you know, erased.
I think the conclusion was that if you really thought it through, it was just a notational variant of transformational grammar.